hearts are filled with expectation. They are filled with love and a passion for you. We have a hunger and a thirst that only you can satisfy.
Lord, we enter this moment with anticipation. We know that in your presence, bodies are healed, broken dreams are restored, and lives are transformed. Because with you, all things are possible.
Lord, we say, as we worship, you are welcome here.
Consume us.
Change us.
Give us visions and dreams.
Give us your heart for the nations.
Give us your heart for this generation.
And Father, let our generation arise and demonstrate the kind of selfless faith that will change the world. Let a generation emerge that will manifest your love in the earth, so that all will come to know you.
As we worship, let your presence fill this room. Release signs, wonders, and miracles. We'll be changed.
We expect an encounter with you.
And we know we'll never be the same as we worship.
As we worship.
As we worship.
At thy throne of grace, I bow my bow my knee. I bow my knee, Lord. Show me. Show me.
The church. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I come before you, Lord, recognizing that you are supreme in authority. Your power is great in the heavens and the earth, and your anger is shown against all wickedness and the evil imagination of men. Father, I boldly approach your throne yet again, this time asking for grace and mercy for your bride, the church. Your word says that judgment shall begin at the house of God. So let the church bear the greatest indictment. Because your invisible works are clearly seen, demonstrating your eternal power and divine nature, all men are without excuse. Yet through hypocrisy, we have given place to your enemies to blaspheme your great and holy name. Because of our perversion and deceitfulness, which brings shame to your name, they question whether we are really your children. For this cause, Lord, we are guilty and bear the greater burden. We have been weighed in the balance and been found wanting. Yet we refuse to change our path. We have been deliberate in our great trespass before you, Lord, and we are not hidden from your sight. We have provoked you to anger with our foolish and unwise behavior, being spiritually blind and naked, allowing the world to see our shame. Heavenly Father, because you are a God of mercy and great compassion, we come before you in humility, that you may examine our ways. We come before you confessing that if we humble ourselves and pray, seek your face, and turn from our wicked ways. Then will you hear from heaven, forgive our sins, and heal our land. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we thank you, Heavenly Father, that your hands are not shortened, that they cannot save, nor your ear heavy, that it cannot hear. We stand before you, Lord, to answer the indictment that has been laid against us, and pray that through repentance our sins will be forgiven. For we have done wicked things in your sight, even rebellion against your commandments and your continued reminders and warnings. In the name of Jesus, we acknowledge our shortcomings and weaknesses, seeking to be washed in the blood of our Savior Jesus Christ. For we were called to be the salt of the earth, a people that would bear witness to your name, follow your examples, live by your commandments, and set a difference between that which is holy and that which is profane. Instead, our hearts have been pierced with the desires of the world, and we have adopted their ways, chasing after materialism and lust and compromising your standards. We have not sought you for who you are, but for what you can give and how much we can get. We have allowed worldliness into your church and created unholy alliances with the world, calling that which is evil good and that which is good evil, while refusing to take a righteous stand. We have sought validation from the world and coveted the admiration of men who have perverted your statutes for selfish gain. We have shown them all that is in your sanctuary, giving access to thieves and robbers who now make merchandise of your sheep and a mockery of your name. We have failed to protect the innocent, neglected the cries of the poor, and watched as families are being destroyed. We have not sanctified you in the eyes of the people, becoming powerless gift chasers who adorn the things on the outside while failing to address the evil within. We have compromised your word by seeking popularity and friendship with the world, choosing to entertain the masses with our talents and gifts while watering down your word and speaking fables instead of convicting people to change. We stand idle as the innocent are snatched from the womb, while we defend the guilty, giving them place on your stage. We are consumed with the pursuit of wealth, while at the same time we are robbed of morality, dignity, and holiness. Through compromise and exploitation, we have lost our influence. Through sermonettes and motivational speeches, we have catered to itching ears. And through hypocrisy and double standards, our pulpits have been stripped of power and authority. We have even embraced the lifestyles of this world and distorted the meaning of your love instead of preaching the sovereign design and plan of God. We have lost our way, Lord, and given over to the cares of this life. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, forgive us, Father, for we bombard your throne with selfish prayers while the world around us declines in decay, drifting further and further away from you. We have been mesmerized by the lust of the world and desensitized by its influences while engaging in unspeakable acts, adultery and fornication, abortions, drunkenness, promiscuity, hatred and insensitivity, drug use, blasphemies, idolatry, man lying with man, women lying with women. We defile ourselves by flooding our minds with pornography, immorality and lust, and other kinds of sexual perversion. We have neglected our children and not taught them your ways, putting success and riches before love and forgiveness, and refuse to show affection, while opening the door for the enemy to wreak havoc in our families. We have become a lukewarm church, lacking holiness and obedience to your word, even denying your name, Lord, and abandoning the cross. We have allowed false prophets to operate in the church while embracing false gods and religions. We are in a backslidden state and confess our sins before you. We were all born into this world with something to surrender, but so many of us have refused to let go, choosing to embrace our fallen nature by making excuses for sin, as opposed to trusting your word for deliverance and healing. In doing so, we have denied the power of the cross and the delivering authority of your resurrection. We go down in the water, but never come up, sinking further and further into the depth you gave your life to conquer. We have titles without meaning, performances without actors, services without substance, and buildings that are lifeless when it comes to the real power of God. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we repent, Lord, and ask for your forgiveness. Lord, let your anger and fury be held back, and let your mercy fall upon us as we repent of our wicked deeds and turn back to you. Let us once again be the people you have chosen to show yourself strong in the earth, that through our examples and trust in your word, the world will once again look to the church for salvation and demonstration of the true power of God. Lord, please hear our cry, incline thine ear, and behold our frail state, that we may eagerly approach your throne with boldness and have confidence at your appearing. Your word says that you will never leave or forsake us, and we come to you by faith, knowing that without faith it is impossible to please you. Deliver us from the guilt of the past and wipe away all condemnation, for through our sin we have given the enemy access to our lives and the legal right to carry out his diabolical plan of destruction against us. But now, Lord, through repentance, his rights have been revoked. In the name of Jesus, we denounce Satan and his demonic forces of evil and his rebellion against the kingdom of God. In the name of Jesus and the finished work of the cross, he loses all rights to torment, deceive, destroy, afflict, and manifest himself in the lives of your people. And we sever all ties, cooperation, agreement, conspiracy, and relationship with the world and the world system. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we command Satan to loose every stronghold, demonic manifestation, false belief, vice, grip, addiction, spell, and curse right now according to the word of God. We choose you, Lord, and the finished work of the cross, and want no part of Satan and the temptations of this world. I declare right now that we are loosed in your precious name. Lord, we renew our covenant and commitment to you and exercise our choice to faithfully serve you with all of our heart, mind, body, soul, and spirit. In the name of Jesus, we make a conscious choice to turn back to you and once again follow after your statutes and commandments and pledge our undivided service and devotion to you. For we have been bought with a price, and serving you is our reasonable service. So help us, Lord, to be lights in this world, ambassadors of the Most High God, and instruments of righteousness, representing your will and not our own. I pray, Lord, that our hunger and thirst for you is never quenched, and that you give us both to will and to do your good pleasure, that we as a church may fulfill the calling and purpose that you have spoken over our lives. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, we denounce the pleasures of this world, false doctrine, and all forms of spiritual adultery. We pray that you expose the synagogue of Satan operating behind church walls, every lying and deceitful spirit, and demons operating as the angels of light. Let us not worship or reverence anyone or anything but the true and living God, and drive out the spirit of Antichrist. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I pray that you remove all doubts and bring revelation to every distortion of the truth, and that we drive out the spirit of Jezebel that teaches fornication, lust, and idolatry. That her curse, seduction, and influence be broken and bound right now in the name of Jesus, and erased from the hearts and minds of your people. I ask, Lord, that the depths of Satan operating in the church be exposed and driven out in Jesus' name, that we no longer defile ourselves through the lust of the flesh and the pride of life, hating all evil, pride, arrogance, and the evil way. Grant us spiritual discernment that we are not deceived. Let us examine the fruit of a man and not be gift chasers led astray by talents, gifts, and charisma. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I pray that the church will once again be known for its good works, love, faith, dedication, patience, and compassion to all men. That we hate the sin but love the sinner, understanding that we have all fallen short of the glory of God. Let us love according to the word of God, standing on the truth, preaching the word in and out of season, and making no provision for the flesh, while understanding that grace is not an excuse for sin and a justification for heaven. Help us, Lord, to minister without compromise to those seeking the truth, and be found without spot or wrinkle, boldly proclaiming the truth of Christ and the power of his resurrection. Let us live and reign with Christ, clothed with holiness and abiding in his presence through eternity. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I speak life into your church and come against all dead things. Let our branches bring forth fruit in their season, and our roots be nourished by the waters of life. Let us be called and set apart, chosen and faithful, serving as kings and priests in your kingdom, knowing that we are in the end times, that we be not lulled to sleep by the passing of days, nor deceived by scoffers who deny your coming, but that we are watchful, and that day does not overtake us as a thief in the night. We are pilgrims in the earth, and this is not our home, so we look forward to the rapture and second coming of Christ, having faith that the promises of God shall come to pass. In the name of Jesus, I pray that we hold fast to our belief that you are the way, the truth, and the life, and that no man cometh to the Father but by you, and that we never lose our boldness and passion for the Most High God. In the name of Jesus and the power of his blood, I pray that we have a desire to spend quality time in your word and in fellowship with you, that we neglect not the fellowshipping of the saints, as we are one in the body of Christ and sealed by the precious gift of the Holy Spirit, that we may all faithfully walk in the calling and purpose we have been given, pressing toward the mark and high calling of Jesus Christ our Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you are able to keep that which we have committed unto you against that day, and that nothing we have done is in vain, but all things are accounted to our heavenly account that we may be rich towards God. Lord, let us run this race with patience, looking unto you who has endured the cross and despised the shame for the joy that was set before you, that our names be confessed before the Father and written in the Lamb's book of life. I pray, Lord, that we are steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the love of God, that we may receive a crown of life promised to those who endure unto the end. Now unto God, who knows the beginning from the end, who is our shield in time of trouble, and who causes us to endure the fiery furnaces of life, we give you honor and praise. We proclaim and ascribe greatness to your name, for your deeds are perfect and all that you do is just and fair. You own the cattle on 1,000 hills and cause darkness to flee in the presence of light. I pray, Lord, that we demonstrate our gratitude for all that you have done by keeping your commandments. For your word says obedience is better than sacrifice, and rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft. Let your word be a light unto our path, revelation in darkness, and our blueprint for all matters pertaining to this life and the one thereafter. It is through you, Heavenly Father, and the power of your might, that one could chase 1,000 and two could put 10,000 to flight. For greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. These things I ask and pray and affirm in Jesus' great and holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Good evening and welcome to L.P.J. 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweetthang End Time Bible Study.
Yeah.
And tonight we have a guest. Well,
yes.
We don't call her a guest because she's my sister and daughter.
Yes.
Okay.
And, yes. So really she's family, she's friends, she's a sister in Christ.
Oh, yes. I love you guys.
Yes.
Amen. Oh, so welcome, sis.
Oh, well, I'm glad to be here. Glad to be here.
All right. Amen.
Exciting. Let's hear what God has to say.
Let's hear what the Lord has to say. And happy Sabbath to you all.
Happy Sabbath.
And we are going to be talking about trusting God's goodness and what scripture we're going to be in Habakkuk.
Oh, my goodness.
Mm-hmm. But we must always start out with a word of prayer and invite God into the house.
Amen.
Always put him first that he may guide us and lead us in the word.
All right.
So let's bow our heads again tonight. Heavenly Father, we come before your throne tonight, Lord, just asking you to walk with us and guide us throughout your word. Help us understand that we don't. Father, fill us with your Holy Spirit that we may understand all that we read and not mislead anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Father, help us to help others that have all walked off and left you, Father, because they misunderstand how good a God you are.
Mm-hmm.
And bring them back unto the house, Father, which you have prepared for us,
mm-hmm.
that we may join hands again and walk with you. Mm-hmm. Father, those that misunderstand your love is because they don't know you.
Mm-hmm.
Is that they misunderstand who you are,
mm-hmm.
That you are life, and you came to give life. So, Father, help them understand who you are. Forgive them for those who walked off. And help them, Father, to find the light again. This we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Amen. So we want you to get your Bibles ready. And we're going to the Old Testament again. And this is another minor prophet.
All right.
As far as I'm concerned, they all are powerful.
Yes.
Yes, they are. And so we're going to be going into Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 14.
Amen.
Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 14 says, "But the time is coming when the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea."
Mm.
Wow.
And the time is here.
So the time.
It's being filled. If you notice that God has made all kind of ways for the world to be filled with his knowledge and his word. Technology has grown so much that you can hear God's word over the air, radio, Bibles that can read to you. I mean, you look and there is a way that you can hear God's word. If you want to, there is no excuse to be ignorant about God's word.
Amen.
Now, God said there will be no excuse this time, because we have so many ways to his word. His word is going to be preached to and from all over this world.
That's right.
And then the end will come.
Amen. So, sis, what else you got to say on this, Habakkuk?
Awareness of God's glory as the waters cover the sea. That means no matter, you know, even in the earth, you will be able to see and be aware of God's glory.
Amen.
Everywhere, all over the world, you will have no, like you said, no excuse for not knowing, because God's glory will shine through and you will be able to see it. So I look forward to hearing what Habakkuk, minor prophet, what Habakkuk has to say about this.
Yes.
That's right. You know, that is very true. Like us, you know, Habakkuk witnessed a lot of injustice and violence and evil on the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Even worse, God seemed to be silent, through it all. Mm-hmm. But he did ask Habakkuk to trust in his promises, as he keeps telling us even today.
Yes.
You know, the prophet did not live to see the fulfillment, mm-hmm. the keeping of those promises, but he learned to trust them anyway. As mm-hmm. he's telling us each and every day, to trust him through and through, no mm-hmm. matter what we see, no matter the pain and suffering that's going on, mm-hmm. we need to trust him.
And no matter what the world presents, you know, a lot of times, what we see in the social media, what we see on the mm-hmm. news, can really cause people to be frightened, and even men to lose heart, and even die. Heart attack. I mean, people have taken their own life. They have just really grew really anxious and fearful and scared. But, you know, we're encouraged, you know, to, if we read the Word of God, it's going to encourage us. I mean, even mm-hmm. though, because this as Scripture says, yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, mm-hmm. I will fear mm-hmm. no evil, for thou art with me. You know, so his rod and his staff will comfort us.
Amen.
And so Habakkuk is going to, you know, he said, I'm going to trust in the Lord. So I'm sure he knew who God was in his life. And it'll be expounded upon more and more as we continue tonight.
That's right. You know, we're going to now go to Habakkuk 1. Mm-hmm. And we're going to read Habakkuk 1 a little bit of, I guess we'll read a little bit of it, and then that way we can.
Habakkuk 1?
Mm-hmm. I'll let you start off, Don, and read 1 through 6, and I can pick up from there.
Habakkuk 1.
Start with verse 1.
Okay, 1 through 6?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm reading from the Amplified, and it says, the oracle, a burdensome message, a pronouncement from God, which Habakkuk the prophet saw. He said, O Lord, how long will I call for help, and you not hear? I cry out to you, violence, yet you do not save. Why do you make me see iniquity and cause me to look on wickedness? For destruction and violence are before me. Strife continues and contention arises. Mm. The fourth verse. Therefore, the law is ineffective and ignorant, and justice is never upheld. For the wicked surround the righteous, and therefore justice becomes perverted. In verse 5, the Lord replied, look among the nations, see, be astonished, wonder, for I am doing something in your days. You would not believe it if you were told. For verse 6 says, for behold, I am raising up the Chaldeans who rule in Babylon, that fierce and impetuous nation who march throughout the earth to take possession of dwelling places that do not belong to them.
Wow. So, go ahead and expound on that.
And Babylon was the name of the magnificent capital city of Babylonia. And the name of the city was commonly used to refer to the entire area, which was located at the eastern end of the Fertile Crescent. Both the plains of Shinar and Chaldea, land of Chaldeans, were part of ancient Babylonia. So, you know, we read it, what they're talking about, and he's talking about the Chaldeans. And he said the Chaldeans were dominant people in Babylonia. Originally from a small part of southern Babylonia, near the head of the Persian Gulf. And they were an aggressive tribe and completely in control country after 625 BC. And Babylon was their capital city and became the scholarly and scientific center of Western Asia. The words Chaldean and Babylonian are used interchangeably. So, I mean, when we're listening to this, this was not anybody. These were dominant people in Babylonia, originally from a small part of the southern Babylonian near the Persian Gulf. So, I mean, can you imagine what they were up against and what the prophet was trying to say?
Right. Wow.
We are Babylon country ourselves right
wow.
now. And we look at what this country began to be, we're just like identical.
It's
we are a child that have been birthed from that country. And if you understand what God told our forefathers, if we don't turn from
the ways
that He will put the same diseases that He put upon them, on us, and He did them, and some that had never been before. And we have turned to be just like them.
Yes, right.
And we are worse than them. Mm. He said we would be worse than them.
Yes.
Look at
us. You can see that now.
Look at us, the laws and things that we are passing. Things that we are saying is okay. Things that we're saying that this the way it should be.
Right.
We are turning away from God and turning to man. God is showing us that the old is a testimony for the new, and the new is a testimony for the old.
Amen.
And He wants us to understand that we must follow the new because it's a witness for the old of what has been that
will
be again. And we must follow and be instructed not to follow what the old has done.
Wow.
And listen to what the new is telling us not to
Amen.
Do. And we all know what the Bible stands for.
Biblical instructions before leaving earth.
And that's what the New Testament came for, is to give us instruction before leaving this
right.
earth to let us know what has been is coming again and do not fall for it.
Amen.
Giving us instruction how to live and follow God before He put us to rest.
That's right. You know, since we was reading Habakkuk and you stopped at 6,
yes,
we're going to go ahead and read like 7 through 11. The Chaldeans are terrible and dreadful. Their justice and dignity proceeds only from themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And their horses also are swifter than leopards and are fiercer than the evening wolves. And their horsemen spread themselves and press on proudly. Yes, their horsemen, come from afar. They fly like an eagle that hasten to devour.
Well, that
sounds like the devil himself.
Wow,
they all come for violence. Their faces turn eagerly forward, and they gather prisoners together like sand. They scoff at kings, and rulers are a derision to them.
Yeah, they were a very fierce nation. They did not have no pity. And they were a very impetuous nation. When they went to do something, they was their ranks. They fell together. And they were going to do evil. They came together doing evil.
And, well, you can actually see that from when you read in the scriptures, you know, Habakkuk is different from other prophets because he does not speak for God to the people.
Mm.
Instead, he speaks to God about the people.
Yeah. Well,
yes.
Say that again.
And see, this,
he does not speak for him, he speaks about him.
And what do we have
God
today? We have a man that walks his earth and say he is God on earth.
Ooh.
What's the difference?
Mm. Mm.
We have got to know, God said at the end we will have prophets to come. And almost through the elect. So we must read the word to know when God is speaking and when a false prophet is speaking. We must know who we are talking to. God has told us what He is, where He's going, when He's coming, how He's
Amen.
Coming, and what He's coming on. That we don't have to be misled.
No, we don't.
Okay? He told us how He left. How He's coming back. He has said that He will not do many miracles in this time because we have His word.
We
don't have to do miracles because He gave His word that we may read His word and know Him by His word. The people before did not have the word. The word was taken from them by the king. He did miracles and things to show them who he were.
Yep.
But this time, Satan will be able to do miracles. So this time, Satan will be able to make fire fall from the sky. Mm-hmm. That's why God gave us his word to read, to know who he is.
Yep.
So we won't be fooled by the enemy, by him doing miracles, making fire fall from the sky, raising the dead, doing these things.
Yeah.
God has told his people what to look out for. So we need to know the word and know who our Father is, so Satan won't fool God's people. It's going to be so close that if you don't have a relationship with God and holding close to God and staying close to God, Satan gonna pull you in.
That's right. Amen, amen.
Yes.
You know, being that you're saying all that, that's why Habakkuk began to struggle to understand God's purpose with his cry out.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, if you look at Psalm 13 and verse 1,
mm-hmm.
we're gonna go to Psalm 13 and verse 1. Amen. So, in verse 1,
okay.
It says, how long will you forget me, O Lord, forever? How long will you hide your face from me? So again, that was a cry. In the Bible, this question is a cry of sadness.
Yeah.
So it suggests that the speaker wishes to be set free from a situation of crisis.
That's right.
Wow.
Because he saw iniquity and he kept asking it.
How long, Lord?
He asked that question.
You know what? Habakkuk calls for help from God about the violence that's happening everywhere in society, just like now.
Mm-hmm.
I think sometimes we all kind of feel that way. Lord, how long?
Well,
the
earth.
Earth is still in the same way.
And what did God tell us, people? These things must happen and it must come to pass. He said, well, my Father said so. Mm-hmm. These things must happen. If he don't, my Father won't come back.
That's right. You know that
they told you these things.
Mm-hmm.
They must come back.
And
they can't change. They won't change. For if they do, one of my word, my Father's word shall fail, earth and heaven shall what?
Pass. That's right.
So what we need to do is get on our knees and pray for God to shine the light for those that want to walk in it. And if they want to walk in it, come to the Father and step out of that darkness.
That's right.
And those that want to step out of the darkness, God will lift them from that darkness into the marvelous light.
So how does Habakkuk, you know, deal with where he's at, knowing who he is? How does he deal with it? Like he asked the question, how does he deal with it from that point?
Right. You know, before I go on to that, I'm going to read, like, the original Hebrew word for violence is hamas. It is used 6 times in Habakkuk's book.
Okay.
So the word suggests acts of injury, both physical and moral, done to others.
Mm-hmm.
Well, because he is a prophet, Habakkuk really knows how much God loves justice and he hates unfairness.
Mm-hmm.
Which we know that. So he wants to know why God lets injustice continue, just like we all do.
Mm-hmm.
But all around, Habakkuk notices violence, lawbreaking. It seems to him that the wicked always win over the righteous.
Mm.
You know, we see that so much. And it seems that justice is ignored by the powerful, just as it was in the time of Amos. That's another minor problem.
Like, you know.
And that is how it is often today.
It is.
Today, Lord help us. You know, but God answers, shows his future plans. The Lord will use the army of Babylon to punish the people.
Oh,
so this announcement surprises Habakkuk. He did not expect God to use such a cruel army to punish Judah.
That's right.
Isn't that something? So that's what he's telling him.
Right.
And that was before they were taken into the land of Babylonians, before the Babylonians took over. That was during, before even Jeremiah's time, when Jeremiah was speaking, Habakkuk was also speaking.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Sure was. Isn't that something?
That's right.
Yeah. Just thinking about how, you know, before they were taken over, and the Babylonians came in, they were warned.
That, see, that's the magic word.
Warning.
That, see, we
that just, woe.
There we go. That woe. See, we have got, like Saul and all of them, they were what? Warned.
Warning.
So all of them were warned.
Mm-hmm.
But did they listen? Well, see, we have to always remember that there is always a warning.
It is before destruction. Mm-hmm.
God has always sent a warning to his people before destruction.
Mm-hmm.
Samuel warned.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
David warned.
Yes.
Huh? See, God has always sent a warning.
It is.
Just like he sent a warning today to you, to me,
to
everybody, he sent a warning to his people to turn
from our wicked ways.
From our wicked ways. Just goes back to 2 Chronicles 7 and 14. We may get tired. We think we get tired of hearing that, but I'm going to tell you some people are going to cry for that.
Oh.
Sure will.
I wish you had to remember that. I wish you had heard that.
That's right.
You know.
That is true.
That's right. Mm-hmm. And Saul had the whole army.
Mm-hmm.
And God spoke. I remember the time that God speak to him.
Oh,
and
goodness.
Saul did.
On several occasions.
Every time he did what he wanted to do.
Yeah, he absolutely did. You know, when, go ahead.
He wanted to please the people.
That's it. That was his
problem. People pleaser. That's one thing that we, even as people of God, have to watch out for. Even having platforms, as we all, some do, and we do, that we have to be careful of not
pleasing
the mass of people or what they think, what they feel.
That's
but
right.
To remember that it's only one that's pleased, the audience of one is just pleasing God.
Speaking the truth as it is in his word.
And he had pride, because he said, I thought my people was hungry, so I kept the calf.
I
thought the king would
be alive.
He meant he could help us. See,
he went on his own.
But he said, listen to the prophet.
That's right.
What the prophet told
him.
And so what we doing today? We're not listening to the prophet.
That's right. When God sent a word, Robert don't know what he's talking about. He ain't nothing but a sinner. Let me tell you, God spoke to a donkey. You better listen. Don't worry about what I am.
And I don't want to rock the crowd.
No, I don't know.
I want to listen to whoever God sent.
So don't worry about what I am. You better worry about what I say.
What was spoken. That's right. You know, in Habakkuk, when we was in Habakkuk.
That's right. Well, you read right there, huh?
Well,
what you read?
Well, like we said in Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 8, you know, the Babylonian army is compared to, what they say?
All right.
To a leopard, wolf,
and
eagle.
They're compared to a
wolf. Okay.
Because when you look in Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 8, it says their horses also are swifter than leopards, and are fiercer than the evening wolves, and their horsemen spread themselves and press on proudly. Yes, their horsemen come from afar. They fly like an eagle that hastens to devour.
But what did God do?
That's right. But see, these are the armies of Babylon.
All right.
And they are the three animals whose speed and power brings terrible death to the animals they have captured.
That's what I'm talking about.
And that's how they were.
That's what I'm saying.
And they were swift.
They were swift. So don't go not to use anybody to send you a message. So never say, come, well, a person is God, not you.
That's right. That's right.
Sometimes when people speak to us, we need to listen and not judge what they are, because you just might be turned away or angry God sent to you. Because God knows that heart, and you know nothing.
We don't know nothing. Amen.
See, this is our problem. God is speaking to you. This is what they did back in those days.
Oh, yeah.
God sent them a word, and because of what brought the word, they ignored it.
You know what? And you're right about that. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 10 and verse 5.
Isaiah?
Mm-hmm. 10 and verse 5. Because Babylonian does not answer to anyone for the cruel and terrible things it does. It breaks the most basic laws of created life. So Isaiah 10:5 says, woe to the Assyrian, the rod of my anger, the staff in whose hand is my indignation, and fury. Theory against Israel, disobedience.
Okay,
but you know the punishment takes place during Habakkuk. Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 5. That's disuse of Babylonian's army raises even more difficult questions about God's justice.
That's what I'm saying. See, we got
we have no idea.
About God's justice, it describes about how swift God's justice
exactly
is.
Right.
When it comes upon the people of disobedience.
That's right.
That's what he said in Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 5. He said, look around you, Habakkuk, replied the Lord, among the nations, and see, like you said, and be astonished.
That's
astounded,
right.
For I am putting into effect a work in your days. Such that you would not believe it if it were told you.
Oh, wow. You would not believe it if it was told
you. See, that's what I'm saying. Just because we cannot be disobedient just because somebody don't go to your church. Somebody don't wear what you want. God can use whom he wants to use.
Yes. So, you know what, since we're talking about that, you're right, he used who he wanted you to use. Go to Acts 13, verse 40 and 41. Because it's a parallel, it is speaking. Go to Acts 13, 40 and 41.
13.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
It says, take care, therefore, lest there come upon you what is spoken in the prophets. Look. You scoffers and scorners and marvel and perish and vanish away. For I am doing a deed in your days, a deed which you will never have confidence in or believe, even if someone clearly describing it in detail declares it to you. He just spoke to in Habakkuk 1:5.
I already told you that.
He's speaking again in Acts.
It's in the Old Testament.
Yes.
The Old Testament builds the New. So it's telling you in the Old Testament what the old prophets have said, what the prophets today saying about what's going to happen in today's time.
That's it.
I told you, the old is the what?
The two witnesses.
Testimony for the new, and the new is testimony for the old. If one is telling what already happened, the other one is telling you, if you do it again, the same thing going to happen to you that happened to them before.
Amen. Before we go on to all of this is so good.
Yeah.
This wonderful sermon, Bible study tonight, it just blows my mind sometimes because this is trusting God's goodness. But before we go on, we're going to take a little music break.
And we'll be back.
And we'll be back. So keep it locked in on L.P.J. 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweet Thing in time, the Bible study. And our guest, Don. So, she's family, so we just do that.
That's okay.
This isn't for everybody, but this is for those of us that need God right now. I wish you'd look down your row and tell him, I need him right now. I'm in a crazy place. I need him right now. I need a healing in my life right now. I need a refuge. I need a safe place. My soul is weary for a spiritual escape. Can I please find solace from this life's tiring race? I need your presence.
Yes, I do.
I need your presence. I need your presence. Now. Will navigate my spirit to you while praise will bring you to my rescue. All I really want is some quality time with you. Lord, I need your presence. I need your presence. I need your presence. I need you now. For when I'm with you, Lord, your joy for my sorrow. When I'm with you, your hope for my tomorrow. Because sometimes I feel like my life is on display. Life's demands, they pull me so joy in your presence. So much joy in your presence. Said there's hope in your presence. So much hope in your presence. There's strength in your presence. So much strength. Presence, yeah. So much life in your presence. Oh, thank you for
presence.
I said thank you for your presence. I don't know where I'd be without you today.
Sing about it.
Oh, yes. I'm telling you.
I'm strengthened. I'm encouraged. I'm not getting your
presence. I'm
telling you. And that was Bruce Parham. That was good.
I'm telling you.
Lord, we thank you for that.
Thank you.
So if you just joined us, You are listening to L.P.J. 64 with Mr. and Mrs. Sweetthing End Time Bible Study. And we have a guest, family, sister,
right,
sister
now,
in Christ,
doing?
Donna.
How you doing?
Yes.
We truly thank the Lord for her being here and enjoying our wonderful Bible study. So it's always a blessing to be together.
Always. Always a blessing, and I'm telling you, this is really good.
Yeah,
and then to hear the word, and then hear the worship.
Yeah.
So
wow.
It just goes along with, and I'm sure that's what Habakkuk had, is a life of worship, and that's why he was asking God these questions.
That's right. So if you just joined us, we are talking about trusting God's goodness. We're going to Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2, 3, and 4.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to read 2, and Don, if you want to read 3 and 4. Okay, and the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and engrave it so plainly upon tablets that everyone who passes may be able to read it easily and quickly as he hastens by.
What's so hard to understand about this? No, what's so hard to understand about that? What is so hard to understand what he told them to write?
Knowing him to write. Let him finish the other two.
Okay.
Go ahead, see 3 and 4.
For the vision is yet for the appointed future time.
Mm.
It hurries toward the goal of fulfillment. It will not fail. Even though it delays, wait patiently for it. Because it will certainly come. It will not delay. In verse 4, look at the proud one. His soul is not right within him. But the righteous will live by his faith in the true God.
Oh, wow. Unbelievable. And that, Habakkuk 2, verse 2 through 4, are some of the most important verses in the Bible. And that is correct.
Mm-hmm.
It shows the true meaning of the gospel.
Now, he said one word too, that
right,
is death to all of us right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it starts with P.
Patience.
And another word starts with
wait for it.
Wait.
And another word starts with P.
Proud.
Proud
one.
That's death for all of us.
If we don't. Honey said, if my people will humble themselves,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
There you go. You got it. That's death for all of us. Because we do not want to get rid of any of it. Not none of it. I tell you, I do not want to get rid of that pride.
That's right.
It never wants to get rid of that pride. We always want to hang on that pride.
Right.
That's what condemns the sinners all in. Because when you keep pride, your purse, nothing comes first. Not even Jesus.
Not
even,
right.
Mm-hmm.
Not even your own child.
Mm. You're right. Amen. You're right about that.
We need to bear that. That's what got that's what got Habakkuk in trouble.
No, Habakkuk was angry about the people.
He was
trying to understand the violence and all that. Lord, why are we waiting? What's going on? Why come you not taking justice now?
That's pride.
God spoke to him.
And he spoke to him and they told him.
Yeah. But that's pride.
Yeah, that's
understanding.
Pride.
That's pride. I understand he was angry. But he
explained it to him. He just want God to, the justice is like
see
the righteous. Well, that's why he's telling him, write the vision.
But he also says in that fourth verse, though, he said, but look at the proud one.
Yes.
His soul is not right within him, but the righteous will live by his faith in the true God.
Yeah.
See, even though he tells him to write the vision, he tells him to wait patiently for it, and then he tells him that to write it plainly up on clay or on tablets. He tells him to for the one who reads it to run. But then he says, the vision yet for the appointed future, the time to wait for it, the goal will not hurry, it will fulfill itself, it will not fail. But even though it delay, prophet, wait patiently for it, because it will certainly come, it will not delay. And he said, look at the proud, prophet. His soul is not right within him.
Right.
The righteous.
That's right. And look at Hebrews. We're going to the New Testament. Hebrews chapter 37 and 38. Hebrews chapter 10, 37 and 38. And that's why you go from the old to the new, is 10, 37 and 38.
Yes.
For still a little while, a very little while, and the coming one will come, and he will not delay. This is what you're talking about. But the just shall live by faith. My righteous servant shall live by his conviction, respecting man's relationship to God and divine things, and holy fervent, born of faith and conjoined with it. And if he draw back and shrinks in fear, my soul has no delight or pleasure in him. So what is he saying? We have to what? Walk by faith and not by sight. Even though what we see is painful, it hurts, the suffering and all that. But he said, wait.
But like Robert said, he was telling the prophet, because sometimes in our anger, in our anxious ways, and how we feel, that sometimes we don't hear the Lord as he's speaking.
Yes.
And the Lord is telling the prophet.
Yes.
The prophet.
Yeah. Right.
He was talking to the prophet. Like, chill out.
That's right. It's okay.
Get this man.
Trust in my promises. Claim my promises.
Right.
Claim down. Okay.
Regardless of how you feel, you're not trusting me. I'm God. Trust me. Look at me. Don't look at the problem. Don't look at the situation. Don't look at what's going on around you. Look at me. I'm the problem solver. Look at me. Don't think about the problem. Don't think about what's going on. I'm the one that's going to solve everything. So concentrate on me.
And he pretty much did tell him that as he was telling him.
Yeah.
Write the vision. He was telling him, stay busy on your job.
That's
stay busy.
Right.
Write it. Do whatever.
Right. God said, whatever goes on, look up.
And you know, that is
okay.
True. But see, Habakkuk was puzzled by the fact that his country will be judged by another nation.
My God.
One that is worse than Israel.
So
that's why he was so confused. And the prophet knows about Judah's sin.
And so we're going to be judged by another country right today.
Yeah.
But God said, stay focused on him. Don't worry about what's going on in the world today. Don't worry about what the news say. Don't worry about Bitcoin. Focus on
digital.
And so, you know, and that is true, but here's what Habakkuk was, his problem, though. He believed that his people are not as wicked as the pagan Babylonians. But what did he say? Sin is sin. That's
God
right.
Said,
he said, because they were disobedient, see, that if they had not, if that were not true, then that the justice wouldn't be coming the way it is. God's justice. Because sin is sin, and God does not look at it like what we look at it. God is God. He does not see sin.
That's right.
And they were disobedient.
That goes to show you where his heart was.
That's right. You know.
That goes to show you where his heart was. That's why God was telling them, shut out.
That's right. Because you're trying to say that your country is not as sinful as the Babylonians.
That's why he said, proud.
Thank you. Okay. Now y'all got me. I'm looking for God.
When he tells us, walk by faith, he also said, this means that the person who lives by faith is not saved by his works.
Thank you.
Instead, a person's works show that he or she lives by faith.
Thank you. That's where I'm coming from.
Amen, amen. So a person's faith is shown in his or her works, and so he or she is promised life eternal.
Thank you.
See, so what so that's powerful. Is what God promised us. Yes. The promises of God.
Thank
yes
you.
And amen.
Thank you. That's a lot of Christian amen problems today.
Amen.
That's a lot of God problems today.
It is. It is.
See, God threw a look back in the field and look at that okra that didn't grow. Mm-hmm. And you'll see your problem. And what you stopped it.
Wow.
See, we really have to look back and look at the history and go back to the old landmark.
Yes.
Go back.
We talked about that too.
We have to go back to see because we're no better than it, if not more worse.
We're not. We're worse.
So how
God is trying to tell us we are worse.
Wow.
So a prophet was puzzled.
He was puzzled. So let's go to Habakkuk 2. We're going to read 5, 6, 7, and 8. You know, 5, we're going to start in verse 5 because we read up to 4.
Okay, Habakkuk, let's go back.
Habakkuk 2, starting with verse 5. I'll read 5 and 6, and you can read 7 and 8 if you want to.
Okay.
Moreover, wine and wealth are treacherous. The proud man, the Chaldean invader, is restless and cannot stay at home. His appetite is large like that of Sheol, and his greed is like death. He cannot be satisfied. He gathers to himself all nations and collects all people as if he owned them. Shall not all these victims of his greed take up a talk against him, and in scoffing derision of him say, woe to him who piles up that which is not his? How long will he possess it? And woe to him who loads himself with promissory notes for usury.
And I feel like the seventh verse says, will your creditors not rise up suddenly, and those who collect from you awaken? And then you will become plundered for them, because you, King of Babylon, have looted many nations. All peoples who are left will loot you because of human bloodshed and for the violence done to the land, to the city, and all its inhabitants.
Wow.
There you go.
You may read 9.
Yes.
Woe. There's another woe.
Another woe.
To him who obtains wicked gain for his house, who thinks by so doing to set his nest on high, that he may be preserved from calamity and delivered from the power of evil.
You say set his nest on high. You mean like so that nobody get to it?
Yes.
Nobody will get to it. Nobody will be able to touch his money or be able to touch his big old tall fences with all these gates that security is supposed to keep covering him.
Like you said, and that enemy will be punished for what he has done.
That's right.
What the wicked do to their victims will, in the end, be done to them. They will get what they have given because God cannot be mocked, made fun of by proud humans. Let's look in Galatians and New Testament.
Go ahead.
6:7.
Oh, Galatians.
Galatians. Galatians.
All right now.
Galatians 6,
all right, 7. Okay, Galatians 6, 7. All right.
Do not be deceived and deluded and misled. God will not allow himself to be sneered at, scorned, disdained, or mocked by the mere petitions or professions or by his precept being set aside. He inevitably deludes himself who attempts to delude God. For whatever a man sows, that and that alone is what he will reap.
All right. For whatever.
Wow.
So did you read 8 though?
Okay. Let me read. Go ahead and read 8. I'm going to let you read that one.
Now he said, for the one who sows to his flesh, his sinful capacity, his worldliness, his disgraceful impulses will reap from the flesh ruins and destruction. But the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life.
Amen. So the oppressor will be judged by God. That's what he's saying.
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. That's why he said, sow your salt.
Sow your reap.
You reap whatever you sow. Like I said, that's one thing about being a farmer. You don't sow. Yeah. You don't sow corn and expect to reap peas.
And you get back more than you sow.
Yeah, and you get back more than you sow.
And even in the next verse, the ninth verse, it encourages us all at the same time, and it says in the ninth verse of Galatians 5:9. Let us not grow weary or become discouraged in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap if we do not give in.
Amen. Yes.
I was telling you, you know, you don't have a lot of time to be good. Time is limited.
It's limited.
See, once you reach that 70 years old, the time that God has given you, your time runs out. God's grace either come in or you go. Because he only promised you 70 some years. You either get it right, then his mercy gives you a little more time. Ain't no that 11 hour ain't for everybody. Don't give it all.
Oh my goodness, you know, it's not. What is this about the 11th hour?
No.
About the 12th hour? Yeah. You know, somebody can very, like, we be scarce. Because some even says in scripture and that we will scarcely ourselves make it. Right?
Yeah.
Saints. Then what will the sinners do?
What will the sinners
do? We will scarcely make it in.
Well, that's a lot of people make on that 11th. I believe the 11th, God have got time for people, for certain people he knows where they need that time. But that's not for everybody.
And we shouldn't bank on
that.
We shouldn't depend on grace.
No.
You know, when people talk about grace, and it is an unmerited favor that God gives us, but you do not take advantage of it.
Well, we got our grace. We got our grace, so we were saved by grace.
But we're not. Yes,
that's your. We've got your grace. Let's not try to run it downhill. We were saved by grace.
Do it too.
Okay, we were saved by grace. We got our grace.
That's right.
Okay.
Because it was undeserved.
That's right. We were undeserved. So let's not.
But this year,
yeah,
we are, because we sow what
that's
we
right.
do.
And
so those things that we are doing in life that we really, you know that we shouldn't, because the things that are happening in this world now is calling right wrong and wrong right, you know, that God will not be mocked.
Right. But God said, you know, then go to show us and that what we're fighting against is two spirits that's fighting.
Yeah.
Good and evil.
Oh, well, yeah.
That's what's happening here.
Fighting against the spiritual in high places.
Right. And that's why you got the thing that's going on.
That's right.
For everything that God made, the other spirit has made the what?
He made a counterfeit.
He made a counterfeit.
He's a counterfeit, and he counterfeits everything that Jesus does.
That's
everything
right.
that God has done. He, the only thing he can't do is he thinks he can create, but he cannot create.
Well, God didn't give him that. God told him that when he kicked him out.
Yeah.
He said, I didn't take anything from you, and I didn't give you anything either.
That's right.
He didn't take anything from him, and he didn't give anything. That's why he was kicked out, because he got jealous that he wanted the right to create.
Mm-hmm.
And to create means he had to have the power over life and death.
Amen. I know that you all want to continue to talk,
but it's time
for us to close.
Oh, it's so good.
But let me finish this out, and then we can, but it's been so good. Habakkuk's faith and the faith of the people gave them strength and hope in those days of terrible trouble. This same faith supports God's people today. So in the darkest hours, under the most difficult situation, the Christian believer may keep his or her soul focused on paying attention to all the light and power of God. So day by day, through faith in God, his hope and courage may be renewed.
Amen.
Amen. So we just want to thank you for joining us again on this wonderful end time Bible study. We want to thank our sister Dawn for joining in with us and just being a blessing as well. And we're going to come back with closing comments and our email address and prayer. So keep it locked in on LPJ 64.
Amen.
Amen. So our closing comment tonight, we must cherish and cultivate the faith that prophets and apostles have shown. It is the faith that lays hold to the promises of God and waits for salvation. Freedom in God's chosen time and way. The sure word of prophecy will meet its final fulfillment in the glorious coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The time of waiting may seem long. The soul may suffer from discouraging situations. Many who have lost their faith may fall by the way. But with the prophet Habakkuk, who tried to encourage Judah during terrible times, let us in faith say, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Wow. Now we have closing prayer. Amen.
A mind to pray. Dear Almighty and Omnipotent God, our Father, our Creator, and everlasting help, we humbly approach your throne in the precious name of Jesus. We eagerly enter your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise, recognizing you are infinite in power and might. The fullness of your ways are past knowing, and your majesty is both seen and felt. Your word says you will grant us the very desire and will to do those things that are pleasing in your sight. In the name of Jesus, the first and the last, we ask for our mind to pray and revelation to have a deeper and more intimate fellowship with you. We ask that you drive out all distractions and the cares of this life and give us a sincere heart to seek your face with great expectation and hope. Let us have the same attitude of Christ, who was totally faithful and dependent on you. In the name of Jesus, help us, Holy Spirit, to submit our minds to the purpose and plans of God while teaching us how to follow him daily. Let us turn from our wicked ways so that our sins be forgiven and that you hear our prayers and restore our land. In the name of Jesus, renew our minds and saturate them in your word, that our thoughts are pure and steadfastly focused on you. Draw us near and let us listen attentively to your voice, cherishing every moment in prayer and fellowship with you. Let us desire your presence more than our natural food, and give us a mind to pray and seek your kingdom above all else, while trusting you to provide all of our needs. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen.
Amen. And may the windows of heaven open and pour upon you a bundle of blessings. And as always, we want to thank you for meeting with us each and every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. that we may have a wonderful Bible study together. And I want to thank Sister Dawn once again. Do you have anything to say, sis?
I enjoyed every minute.
Amen. So may you come again Monday. May you have a wonderful and blessed Sabbath. And remember, if you have Bible questions or you need prayer, you can always email us at robtgina50@gmail.com. And have a wonderful and blessed night.
Good night.
Good night.